Hi. So we're pretty blank, actually. This is the way we seem to work is that we just show up and we don't have a plan. So the only thing that we've heard for this session is one song. So I'm going to play the song and then we'll see what happens after that. You can close your eyes if you like, if you want the full experience, or whatever you feel comfortable.
One of my pet peeves right now. Joan, would you go get the peeve from the cage? Don't worry, it's on a leash. Seriously, a pet peeve. This is my thing. Music has the power to really touch people, reach people, uplift people, instruct, educate, heal. And popular music, you know, especially love songs, cannot do it. The songs that you listen to on the radio, most of them are really about codependency and fear and holding on. And, you know, once you have found her, never let her go. Let's be serious about that. If you really use that as your philosophy, you'd end up having a lot of restraining orders on you. What we consider romance is not very healthy. You know, you made me love you. I didn't want to do it. I didn't want to do it. I can't smile without you. Get a life. So this is my little antidote. I call it number 15 codependency block. Because if you sing this little ditty, your mind will be protected, shielded from the negative effects of the lyrics of today's codependent songs. And then you can enjoy them and not be freaked out by them. So please join me in learning this and we can sing it together and then go through some of our favorite oldies. Just a codependent love song. One that's filled with pain and misery. Just a codependent love song, glorifying insecurity. Okay, let's sing that together. Just a codependent love song. One that's filled with pain and misery. Just a codependent love song, glorifying insecurity. I know I'll never love this way again, so I keep holding on till the good is gone. Just a codependent love song, one that's filled with pain and misery. Just a codependent love song, glorifying insecurity. The 1950s was a time where the United States government was experimenting with subliminal technology to see how it might affect the masses of people like you and me. They put some of these messages, these subliminal messages, underneath some of the 50 songs that we were listening to. And if you listen to your old 45s really carefully, you might be able to find some of these hidden subliminal messages. Listen very closely right now and try to find the hidden message of blame and being a victim underneath the following. Yeah, yeah, yeah. You don't remember me, but I remember you. Not so long ago, you broke my heart in two. Tears on my pillow, pain in my heart caused by you. You. Did anybody find it? A lot of psychics in Detroit. Just a codependent love song. One that's filled with pain and misery. Just a codependent love song, glorifying insecurity. Well, we can go on all night, as you know, but we're going to close this melody with a song that Barry Manilow won his 12th Codependent Grammy of the Year. you're glad if you knew what I'm going through. I just can't smile. Just a codependent love song. What this girl in pain and misery. Just a codependent love song. Glorifying insecurity.
So that was Scott Grace. He's actually A Course in Miracles singer, songwriter, comedian. And, it's a pretty funny look at the ego's use of relationship. Sorry. Is it
okay? Yeah, that's it. I mean, that sums up what relationship is really about, the special love relationship Jesus talks about. And when you hear it like that, it's pretty funny. You look at it, oh, that's really funny. But it's what it is, you know, and it's actually shocking, actually. You know, the special love relationship is full of misery, actually. You know, this idea of loving a special one, having this special one, and I've got to treat them specially, and I've got to be this particular way with them. Oftentimes we're walking on eggshells with them, or, you know, we don't want to upset them, we don't want to upset the apple cart. You know, all these kind of things is actually complete compromise, which is completely opposite to what Jesus is teaching us in the Course. So it really is an undoing to actually change this mindset. And the Course in Miracles is just wonderful for that. The workbook is an amazing journey to help undo this special love relationship. And of course, it's not just with a special love partner, it's with anyone, actually. It's with our parents, with our siblings, with our children, with co-workers, you name it. We've actually got a special relationship with all of them, and with food, and with anything in the world, actually, and the cosmos. The whole cosmos, in fact, is a special relationship. There you go. Jesus doesn't, you know, mix words about that, that really we have a special relationship with everyone and everything. And so there really is an undoing to be done if we want to awaken. And so it's actually a difficult journey to do by yourself, you know, without the Course, and certainly without mighty companions, which we're very big on, just having people of like mind you can actually join with in study groups, very helpful. We actually live in community. It's something that we find incredibly helpful. It's not necessarily for everyone, being in community, but it's something you really, if you're drawn to it, it's a step that I found I could not take. And I never thought I'd live in community, and I didn't think I'd certainly be with the ones that are in the community that I'm in. But you don't get to choose that, as Jesus says, because of course, if you want healing, you're going to be given those that are there to aid the healing. And, you know, we're given these all sorts of projects and things that are going to help bring up and flush up whatever isn't real, whatever isn't love and the truth. And I think a lot of Course in Miracles students really shy away from undoing the blocks. But that's all we can do. Jesus says that love is beyond our comprehension. It's beyond our understanding. It's pretty shocking. We talk about the special love relationship. We think we know what love is. We have no clue. No clue whatsoever, Jesus says so clearly. The best we can do is undo the blocks to the awareness of love's presence. That's the best. And that's everything, actually. It might seem like, oh, really? But undoing those blocks, and we've seen it, the more we undo the blocks, the more we can open up to love, the more joyful and inspired and vibrant and everything becomes so much better. Our minds become clearer, we start experiencing more of this peace by undoing the blocks. So, undoing the blocks is not just something you can think about or talk about or just read the Course and do. We oftentimes, David talks about the Course really being 1% of the journey to read the course, doing the theory, studying the book, 1% journey. Read it back to front, know it back to front, 1%. It's 99% experience. It's actually experiencing. And so undoing the blocks is incredibly important. So it's beyond philosophizing, way beyond the philosophizing. So undoing the blocks is actually letting up whatever is there that feels like a block. Anything that feels like, that doesn't feel good. You know, if it's an emotion, if it's a thought that you're having that's lingering in your mind, that needs to be expressed. It needs to be let out. And there is some discernment we need to have in the world, not to just unleash on a co-worker or what have you. But when we've got mighty companions, and certainly if you're in a relationship where there is an agreement that, yes, we're here for healing, that is our most important goal. That's all we want, is the healing. Then there's room for this undoing the blocks to the awareness of love's presence. In community, we actually have these things called expression sessions. We also call them altar sessions, where we are very, very open about whatever's coming up for us. And it's an incredibly healing process. And for Melanie and I, we met in 2009, and our whole intention before we met was about healing, and then we were given by the Spirit. And so there was this relationship that I thought, oh, we're in a holy relationship, this is great, there's nothing much to undo here, we're just in a holy relationship. Little did I know that there was, yeah, that was, this one was given to undo these blocks. And it's been quite a ride, and quite a journey, and incredibly healing, and there's no way I would want it any different, you know, which I'm just so happy to be able to say. That it's been incredibly healing to be able to let up these blocks with our companion and with others in the community too, that are just so willing to let you, you know, expose your junk, you know, the stuff that's actually in your mind, stuff that you really just need to release. So willing to just hold the space and be in true empathy so that can be released, so we can really undo these blocks to the awareness of love's presence. So this is not a casual journey at all, you know. This, you know, Course in Miracles study groups are so important, and they're so important to get in touch with the theory of the course. And I loved it so much. And, you know, I was on this high when I first went to a study group. And then soon after, I found I just needed to go further. You know, I needed to get more involved in the experience, so involved with mighty companions, people that are really willing to heal, really willing to take that next step of, okay, let's do what Jesus is saying here, rather than just talking about it, was such a helpful step. So, I just want to make it clear, because Kate mentioned to me, some people seem to think they've just got to go to community to wake up. No, that's not the case. This is, it's a highly individualized curriculum, Jesus says. However, a universal experience is required, you know? So, and the universal experience is undoing the blocks to the awareness of love's presence. So being able to have those you can have around you, ones that are willing to join you in this healing uncompromisingly, without compromise, right? Without deciding, oh, this is okay to say and this is off limits. That just doesn't work. That's compromise. And that's very limiting. It's just not going to work. Know if we're going to have an opportunity during this weekend to have an expression session or really get into the practice of this. We will actually next week. We've got a retreat actually for a week in Mudgee, just 4 hours west of Sydney at our community place there in Living Miracles. It'll be an amazing week actually of experiencing this, actually really getting together and saying, okay, let's let it all hang out, you know. And there'll be some very, very deep healing next week with this retreat. So. I thought I didn't have anything to say, but there you go.
Yes. Question.
May I ask if, in the first stages of your honeymoon stage...
I'll just grab the mic.
May I ask, in the first few stages stages of your honeymoon getting together, is that anything to do with love, the being in love stage? I realise there's no such thing as conditional love, but what is that stage we're in when we feel we're in love and the world looks wonderful?
He has no idea. Well, I was just sitting here thinking before you asked the question, the thing I love about A Course in Miracles and the Holy Spirit is the Spirit's always so willing to meet the mind exactly where it is. You don't actually have to skip from A to Z, and I was one of those who thought that I would just skip a bunch of steps and suddenly wake up in nirvana. It actually hasn't been that. David reminds us all the time, and Jesus says, you know, for most, it's a slowly evolving path. So for me, I'd been married for 11 years, and I was guided to leave that marriage, and I knew that I wanted to have a kind of relationship. I was married to a beautiful man, beautiful. It was very difficult to leave because he was just so lovely, and there wasn't really any reason to leave except that I knew I was called to something, and that wasn't supporting that, and I was really just trying to drag him with me, and that wasn't working. And so I left, and there was still a desire in my heart and my mind for that version of relationship, because I just thought that there must be a way that you could have that and that it could be used for healing. And so it was pretty rapid. The Spirit brought this symbol in within 3 months of leaving my marriage. And I would have to say that the first 2 years that we were together, I was pretty much just in love with an idol. And even though I thought that I wanted the Spirit and I wanted the peace of God, and I was still following my intuition and taking the steps that were given to me, but I was just totally in love with the idea of being in love. And the Spirit won't let you hang out in that for very long, not if you're seriously called to wake up. And so I think it was 3 weeks after we got married in 2012, Michael left the country and he went off to our monastery in Utah for 9 weeks. And I actually felt like my legs had been cut off, and it was an enormous undoing of what I thought I needed. And it was really the first opportunity that I had to see the special hate that's underneath special love. And so Jesus has 9 chapters in A Course in Miracles about special relationship. And as you pointed to, it's not just the romantic love version, it's all special relationship. And they're all used by the ego to keep us in linear time, like this way. Because love is this way with the Spirit, it's the holy instant. It's never got anything to do with people. But what I love is that the Spirit has used my desire for that version of relationship to bring in the one that would meet what I would need for my healing. And so we always get exactly what it is that we need. And there's been many times over the last 7 years I probably wished that I knew what I was doing before I'd said yes. But actually I've never felt like I've had a choice. And over the last 7 years, there's been a lot of time where we actually haven't been together. The bodies haven't been together. And so it's been just a falling back into the mind of what Jesus is pointing to, that the only real relationship is with God. And so then I feel like we've probably had about 25 honeymoons and, I don't know, 100 first kisses. And because it's always new, like, We were given a centre in Canada to oversee together. We had just joined the Messengers of Peace, which is just a symbol for total devotion to following the Holy Spirit's guidance 100%. And yeah, we've got even this centre to run together, and that was just I've lost what I was going to say about that. Yeah, I know. I don't know if that answers your question. It's just always a fresh opportunity to meet my brother anew, because if I think I know anything about this symbol, I'm lost. It's like what Sonia was pointing to. If we meet anyone with any idea of who we think they are or what they mean or the meaning that they have for us, then we're not seeing our brother as they truly are. And so I feel, actually, we were praying before we came in this afternoon, and I was just in tears of gratitude. I have so much gratitude for what's been given, and that I can just show up and serve. And yeah, it gets to be more like that, like a happy surprise, rather than this old feeling of in love. And I would have thought I'd be a hopeless romantic my entire life. Like, I really thought that was the one thing that could never be undone in my life, because I seemed to be so addicted to needing that version of love that really has nothing to do with love. It has been my experience. But that doesn't mean that an experience of love can't come into the mind and then that can be seen to be shared while I still believe in this form. Does that answer your question?
Can I ask possibly a very naive question? Thank you. What does living in community mean? Mm-hmm. I don't fully understand.
I actually don't understand that either, and it's something that I seem to hear a lot of from different ones, because to me, I feel like for my journey with the Course in Miracles, well, with my whole life actually, but particularly when the Course arrived, I just knew I would never have to read another book again, but that was it. And so for me, I was guided to, well, I met David here in 2007 in this very hall. And I sat down with my first husband, and as he was speaking, he was with Kirsten Buxton, I just heard in my mind, oh, this will be your life. I was like, whoa, you know, that's not my plan for my life. And so then I went off and did my hard dance thing for a couple of years. But eventually I reconnected with him a couple of years later in Sydney, and I heard follow David. And in the moment I thought, does that mean literally? Like, he was on his way to the airport that day. No, in your mind. And so for me, the Holy Spirit guided me very directly to become a messenger of peace, to give up, you know, what seems to be the different things in my life, not give them up. I don't feel like I've given them up, but I let them fall away, and I got taken into something else. And so for me, I don't ever think about in community and out of community. I feel like I'm in community in my mind with everybody that I meet. So, but perhaps more what you're speaking to, we live together. Some of us are drawn to live together, and we never would have thought that that's what we want to do. It's not easy. Those of us who are here, it can be very intense because there's a shared purpose, so it can be a very helpful step. And mostly though, people now come and just stay with us, and then they take those learnings and the tools back to their own life, because the shared purpose is to heal. And so there's nothing off the table. Everything of the ego can be seen and let up for healing. And we never hold our brother to anything that he said, even if it was 5 minutes ago or a minute ago. It's like our practice is to see the Christ, and if we're not seeing the Christ, it's like, okay, back to my mind. So yeah, we have centres around the world. We have a new centre in Spain, one in Australia in Munchie, one in Chapala, Mexico, and a monastery in Utah, and a centre in Utah as well. So, but it's all sort of naturally evolved. We've never tried to make anything happen. People are just drawn, like Michael was saying. You're either drawn or you're not, and there's nothing right or wrong about it. But for me, I was inextricably drawn. I couldn't have not done what was given for me to do. Thank you. Yes?
When you say Christ, when you said you see the Christ in everyone, what exactly do you see? Like, do you see love for your brother and sister, or is it other things? I'm not sure what I should be looking for in people if I'm seeing the Christ.
Yeah, thank you. It's a great question. It's really seeing beyond the facade. You know, it's going beyond the idea of looking at a face. You know, eyes, the colour of the eyes, or the hair, or male or female, or a person. Actually, this is actually an undoing of personhood. You know, a complete undoing of an identity, whether it's, you come from a particular, you're Australian or American, or you know, you're a particular religion, you're a Catholic person, or a Course in Miracles person, or you go for that president or that president, or whatever it is. If you think you're from planet Earth, that's an identity. This isn't a complete stripping away of everything you think and think you know. It's a Buddhist term, but it very much does relate to what Jesus is saying in the Course. This is an undoing of everything. And when you follow what Jesus is saying in the text, and you do the lessons of A Course in Miracles, and you do the two simple guidelines that he gives you in the workbook, just do one lesson a day, and try to make no exceptions in applying that lesson for that day. If you really do that, this is what you're coming into. You're coming into a complete stripping away of everything you think you think and think you know. All identity, you're undoing time and space. Kate read something of it earlier, that beautiful passage about undoing time and space. This is not a casual endeavor. These aren't just words, I went through the Course in Miracles the first time because I was just so drawn to it. I just fell in love with this thing, and I was only just glee doing this Course in Miracles, and I went through the whole workbook, actually. And I got to the end and said, I don't actually feel enlightened. I thought I'm supposed to be in this moment. And what I did was I actually did just gloss through it, actually. I did it as a matter of, because this is what I'm supposed to do, so I'm going to go for it. But I did it pretty diligently most days. I think I did it about a year and a half, the actual workbook. But I didn't fully apply it at all, actually, when I really looked at it the first time through. So it's not going to do it. If you're just going to read those lessons and you're just going to read the text and you think that's going to enlighten you, it's just not going to. It's as simple as that. Might be the bad news. You can't put it underneath, sleep on it each night and think, okay, I'm going to get it by osmosis. using it as a doorstop definitely doesn't work. It's actually got to be fully applied. And when you apply that, then the stripping away starts happening. You've seen the Matrix. You start seeing. Just starts having these experiences of, this world really isn't real, And we don't like to use those words lightly. Jesus talks about it, but a lot of Course in Miracles students I notice really use those words very lightly. Oh, this world's an illusion, and when they get sick, I'm not a body, I am free, for I am as God has created me. That's just not helpful at all. In fact, it's the ego getting a hold of these concepts. It's about really applying them truthfully. And as you apply them, the world really does start becoming a matrix, if you like. Things start falling away. People are not people. I've actually peopled this world. That's what I've done with my mind. And when we start getting in touch with that, we start getting in touch with the power of the mind. We created this cosmos as a distraction device. That's all it is. It's a distraction. So this is what's being undone. And so as we start willingness, even just having some willingness to look at my brother differently, right? Being able to see through the facade, go beyond my judgments of their height or their colour or their eyes or whether they're attractive or not attractive. But when I can just start stepping back a little bit from that and just watch my mind, you start seeing the judgments, the distractions. That's what they are. They're simply a distraction from the peace of God. All those things. So the thoughts are going to come in. The more I don't identify with them or attach to them, get hooked on them. And a sort of great saying one time about, have your front and back door open in the mind and let the thoughts run through. Just don't invite them for tea. So it's not about not having thoughts. I remember I was doing meditation practices for a long time thinking, oh, damn, I've still got these thoughts. I've got to get rid of these thoughts for me to be. To be enlightened, if you like, to get a peaceful mind. It's just not true. You can just letting the thoughts go without hanging on to them is what it's all about. And so the more I can just let the thoughts go like a parade. Lesson 10, Jesus says it so beautifully. Watch it like a parade. Just don't jump on one of the floats, is the way I like to look at it. Or look at them as passing clouds. And the more you do that, the more you can just really experience not being attached to the past or the future. Just not trying to activate the past, plan for the future, or organize the present in any way. The more you can just start withdrawing from that, the more you're going to start seeing the Christ in your brother. The more you're going to start seeing this world becoming a movie set, a place that really isn't real. But I can't emphasize enough that But these are words, and it's got to come to an experience, and there's no easy way around it than actually applying the course completely and wholeheartedly, like nothing else you've ever done before. The most important thing is to completely apply the course, as Jesus tells us. He's the master. He knows. And it's beautiful. We saw a movie just very recently called Amongst White Clouds, and it was about Chinese monks, some Chinese people that have just renounced the world and gone into the mountains. And it was beautiful hearing them being interviewed where they've renounced everything. They're just in the mountains and they're hermits. And there's miles between them. They live by themselves completely. And in fact, some of these guys wear the robes that other monks throw off, right? So that gives you an idea. They're just totally, no distraction whatsoever, just very subsistence living. And they were being interviewed saying, well, what do you do? You know, why do you do this even? And for them it was like, if I do anything else, it's going to be a complete distraction from my devotion to God. It was actually very, very touching. It's something that I feel like I'm stepping into further, and it's my wish for that. It's my goal, and that's what I believe we're stepping into deeper and deeper. I don't want any distraction, not the slightest distraction in my mind from my devotion to God, to be able to come into that, the peace of God. Because why? Because it's meaningless. Jesus tells us so clearly. It's meaningless. Not only is it, you know, do I be seeing an angry world or a bad world or even a happy world? You think we're seeing happiness or joyful. We're seeing a meaningless world, and to that, the ego is devastated. And we're here to devastate the ego. Not about trying to make it wrong or try to kill it off or do anything really heavy duty with the ego. It's actually not paying it any attention whatsoever. And in not paying it attention, we start seeing the Christ in our brother. We start seeing through the facade. And that's a truly joyful experience, you know. Truly joyful.
Just because I think your question was asked of me, something that I'd said. I don't feel like I experience seeing the Christ in everybody. I think what I was pointing to was in my mind. I don't really experience difference in terms of relationships, but yeah, I'm still very much working that, because I think the course is, you know, it's about removing the obstacles to the presence of love's awareness. And so judgment is always going to come. And yeah, even recently I was in Utah with Michael for a month, and I was shocked because I thought I was going to be there and just be in love and be happy, but actually I was just in total judgment of him, pretty much 24/7, everything he said and did. I couldn't stand it. I just wanted to get the hell out of there. I wanted him to leave, or I wanted to leave. I thought, this is a big mistake, it's ridiculous. And so it's more just not like, how do I try and see the Christ in my brother? It's more like I observe the obstacles to seeing the Christ in my brother, and be willing for those to be healed. Because he was really just showing me my own walks. But yeah, practical application.
There's a question, Jeffrey, there's a question right at the back.
Things about relationships is the lack of communication. Because we're all human, my confusion is, how much do you actually state the things that are affecting you in a negative way? You know, like, how much do you say and how much do you not say? Do you know what I'm saying?
Yes. Yeah. Yeah, for us we have a shared purpose of healing, so it's a little simpler than it perhaps if you were in a relationship with someone where that wasn't, you know, you didn't have that in place. But even having said that, I know that for the first 2 years that we were married, there was probably a lot that I wasn't saying to Michael, and I didn't even know that until probably a couple of years after those 2 years, because there was a lot of fear. There was so much fear in my mind of loss. What would happen if I lost that symbol? And actually that fear ended up you know, it will make that happen in a way. So there was a lot I was withholding, and yet I would have thought at the time I was, oh, just telling him everything and so willing to share my private thoughts. And then when he shared his thoughts with me, I was just taking it personally, really. I mean, I thought I was doing a great job of like holding the space, and but I actually wasn't. And so it wasn't until probably fairly recently that something had shifted in my mind where it wasn't, it was like Kate is speaking to this morning about that single desire. You know, if you still have a desire for something, for anything in this world, so I still had a desire to be in relationship this way, that was getting in the way. And so that's fallen by the wayside recently, where it's like, well, this could come and go, and my desire is just so singly focused on the spirit that actually now it's being used to just say everything, and I don't care what, you know, what the result is in terms of the form, whether a relationship stays together or doesn't stay together, because I just want to go for it with my mind in terms of healing. And so recently my experience in Utah, we were there together for a month, and we actually hadn't seen each other for 2 years. And so I was shocked that all of this was coming up, but it did quickly move into a place where I didn't need to speak everything. It was like I would catch myself, and we had these things stuck all over our room, which was pause something or other. But anyway, pause. The thing was, yeah, the pause was the important part, like Sonia was talking about. I was literally just reacting from the ego. The ego just wanted to be right. That was it. I just wanted to be right. And so it was like pause and just check in. What would you really have me say? And what is it really that I need to see in my mind? Because it can't really be about this character out here, you know. So there was a bit of a transition where it started, I was saying a lot of things, you know, but then it was like, okay, I really don't even need to speak that anymore. And just, so it's kind of a bit of a practice and depends on the relationship. If there's a shared agreement, like, let's just really go for this for healing, and we don't care what comes up and what happens to the relationship, because it's all for love. It's for that present moment experience of love. So I think you just practice with it. And if you don't have that in that particular version of relationship, perhaps the spirit will bring mighty companions for that in other ways, that you can just say all your thoughts and know that they're the ego and know that they're just being shared to be healed. Is that? Yeah. It takes a lot of courage, really, to practice that. But it's what we do in our centres. We have no private thoughts and no people pleasing. And so it's not like everyone's running around going blah about all their thoughts all of the time. There's forums for that. And like I've shared, it's all for healing. And if you're fronting up to one of those sessions and you're just expressing because you want to be right, well, nothing's really going to shift. It's like, no, you have to really want to show up to be wrong. And as quick as I would show up in front of him and be like, oh my God, I don't want to so be wrong because I don't like how I feel, you know, like in the rules for decision, you know, at least I can, you know, I do not like how I feel, so I hope I have been wrong. It's like as quickly as I could get to that place, it's like, oh, the peace would be back in my mind. And it really didn't matter what he did or didn't do. So, yeah. It's fun. It can be fun, actually. It's fun to see. I think Kate said this. It's fun to see the blocks come up because it's like, yeah, bring it on. Let's bring the healing on. We don't want to linger in time.
Yeah. It's an amazing thing that happens when you have that shared agreement and one brings up these blocks. They think this is the worst thing I could be doing, and what is the other one going to think, and I'm going to lose the love or whatever your idea of love is or this companionship. And what actually happens is you fall deeper into love. You actually feel the connection anyway much deeper when the shared agreement there. It doesn't matter what's being said. If it's being released, you can feel it and the connection becomes stronger. And the more you do it, this is a practice, the more you do it, the more it becomes addictive, actually. You just realize, oh, wow, I just want this connection. There's nothing else I want. That vibrational connection is nothing else that we want. There's nothing else that we can really hope for, actually. And what else is there? But besides having this connection, you've experienced it a bit today, you know, this beautiful connection is available all the time. You know, it doesn't just have to be here. It's available all the time. And it's got to come from a real willingness, a decision to say, I want this above everything else. Yeah, something might come at me and I think, whoa, that's not very nice. You know, whatever it is, and yet it's the most helpful thing for them to be able to release. And with that shared agreement to say, I want to see this differently. Kate was talking about it earlier, which I loved. She had that in her mind a lot about, I want to see this differently. I'm willing to be wrong about this, you know. Jesus says a very, very simple thing in the course that I apply a lot, and it's such a helpful thing to say, do I want to be right or do I want to be happy? Just, if you can apply that, whenever you're thinking you're right about something, or whenever you're thinking anything, actually, you can just say, do I want to be right or happy about this? And particularly when you're joining with another, it's such a powerful thing to see. You start seeing, whoa, how often I want to be right about something. Right? Right about anything, you know? And remember, it's right or happy. I remember thinking, oh, and I remember saying it to you a couple of times, I'm right and happy about this. No, it's one or the other. It's diametrically opposed. It's impossible. Even though I have all the factual basis and everything else, it's just not true because the facts don't matter, actually. The facts are an egoic idea. And so it really is about what's happening in the mind. Am I happy? Or am I not happy? If I'm not happy, I'm being right about something. It's as simple as that. It really is as simple as that. How easy is that? I'm not happy. Like, I must be wanting to be right about something. So therefore, I'm willing to be wrong about it. I want to change my mind about it. That's so powerful. It's amazing. It sounds so simple. We just gloss over things like this that Jesus did. Oh, yeah. Applied, though, I can tell you, it's just, I don't know, it's been so liberating for me and for those around me. It's amazing. So, and we call each other right. That's the great thing about having mind and companions. You know, if you're being right about something and you're not budging, it's like, hey, buddy, I think you're being right about this. You know, and again, the shared agreement, you say, oh, wow, thanks. You know, or they're going to do whatever they're going to do with it. It doesn't matter because you're just saying what you need to say. You know, and really, you know, that's the most helpful.
Yeah, Jesus says, I don't know what chapter it's in, but he's talking about when you shift the purpose of your relationship from the ego's purpose to the Holy Spirit's purpose, you can expect the fireworks to go off. You know, he doesn't use that word, but you can expect that it's like a ship that, David has this analogy, it's like a ship that's sunk to the bottom of the ocean, the egoic thought system, and the Holy Spirit has to make this transition to turn the ship completely up the right way and up to the surface. It's like your whole thought system has to shift from out there, from a getting mechanism, to back to just in alignment with the Spirit. It's a massive undertaking. So you will want to leave your brother as that shift is happening. And he says to expect that. But that's when you fall back on your knees in gratitude of like, okay, thank you, you're my Saviour, you know. And we're in this together. And I'm not just talking about this version of relationship, but any. You might have a friend where you guys decide, okay, let's go for purpose, you know, let's go for healing and holy relationship. Well, you can expect that everything that's hooking you together in terms of guilt, because we have all these little arrangements with each other that we're not even aware of, like, well, you do this for me and I'll do that for you. And they're so subtle and they just keep us locked into this linear experience as a person. And so that's all the Holy Spirit is ever trying to do, is to loosen that identification as a little self. And that's the only reason why the ego wants to hold on to any relationship, is because it thinks its safety is in the form. But the Spirit's like, no, I have somewhere much more beautiful to take you. So don't worry if it gets rocky. It's going to. That's the good news, actually. We pray together. I've tried to leave Michael I don't know how many times. Yes.
What about sensuality in a holy relationship? Does the libido totally disappear?
No. So that's the short version. But there's, yeah, it's great. When you give everything over to the Spirit, let's use a relationship. If you give the relationship over to the Spirit, then it's in the Spirit's hands. And so the Spirit can use anything that the ego made. It can use anything in form, whether that's a relationship, sex, food, you name it. The Spirit can use anything. And so there's no holds barred when it comes to the Spirit to be able to use anything in form. And so, yeah, there's these funny ideas that I've got to go into celibacy now because that would be required of me. Why? It is a form-based thing that the ego made. The Spirit can use it. And it has to be given to the Spirit. It is one of those areas that is very, very touchy. The ego's one of the ego's most boasted gifts is the special love relationship. And what's one of the most boasted gifts inside the special love relationship is sex. So it's really one of those areas that the ego just thinks it's got all over you. But the more we can give ourselves over and really be prayerful about everything in our relationship, particularly with sex, you know, it's one of those things to be really mindful of. It's amazing what can happen. And in fact, I can say we were just talking about pausing, using that pause in everything that we do, just taking a step back for a moment. Because the ego speaks loudest and first. That's what we've been reacting to for millennia, for lifetimes. The spirit is the little soft voice back there. It's always been there. You know, from the moment the separation happened, the spirit was given us. Been there the whole time. We've just ignored it, or we just haven't listened to it. We've listened to the voice of the ego, the one that drowns out the spirit by talking loudest and first. The only way to hear the spirit, really, until you become, as Jesus says in lesson 97, I am spirit, until you really are become one with the spirit, is to pause. So we use pausing and praying a lot. We talk about it a lot because that is an incredible undoing ego mechanism, to pause and pray, and particularly in relationship, and I would say particularly even in intimacy, where it may even seem like, you know, you've got a technique or something. You know, I have to do a lot of practice around this, I've got to say. It seems like, you know, when you start sex, then you finish it. No? It's like, but to be able to pause when things don't feel quite right, this is with everything, but I would say particularly with sex, if you can just pause and think, you know, something's not. Or just pause anyway. There was just incredible power for me when I started doing that, how then spirit oftentimes would redirect. Well, this is weird, I've never even done this before, and suddenly there's all this joy and inspiration that comes from it. It gets really, everything becomes transformed, and I've been amazed by something that I might have even thought I was good at, or the other partner did, or whatever, or, you know, I had a particular way of doing things, and it gets completely retranslated by the spirit. Not just with sex, with everything. I've just noticed how things are completely retranslated, because the ego thought system and the spirit thought system will not meet. They're like railway tracks. There is no meeting point, ever, with anything. And so there is a retranslation, so it is going to be different. So if you do anything like you've always done and think you're going to get enlightened by that, you know, or awaken from it, or it's going to be what Jesus is saying in the Course, it's just not true. It can't be. Things are going to have to shift, you know, in the mind, and the way we do things is going to shift. So that takes a lot of willingness, actually, to be able to do that. And it is, you know, that takes a lot of trust. It's the first characteristic of a teacher of God, Jesus says. And you've got to go all the way through the 10 characteristics to the end one. Like the 10th characteristic of a teacher of God is what? Open-mindedness. To be open to the Spirit. To allow the Spirit to come through. To be willing to put aside everything that I think and think I know. To be able to let the Spirit come through. In everything. No matter what. This is an undoing belief exercise, this whole thing. It is an experiment. I heard earlier in the day about it's like a big experiment, I think Sophie said. And that's it, treat it like a big experiment. You know, go in there and go for it. And do things differently than you've ever done before by just pausing for a minute. Pause. It's something that drew me to the first time I saw Messengers of Peace with Jason and Kirsten happened to come to Australia in 2009. I saw people asking them questions and I saw them pause and I went, well, that's weird, seeing people pause. Not just weird, I thought, wow, that's amazing, you know, that they would take a moment and actually pray about answering the question. And from that time, I've been really taken by that, and I've really watched myself how I just keep wanting to just go ahead and do something, answer a question, or just go ahead and think, oh, I'm just going to go do that now, whatever that is, rather than pausing and praying. Pause and pray. Yeah.
Yeah, I would say I don't really relate to the word libido anymore, but because I just feel like my whole life is just a prayer. Not in the way that I even have to really pray anymore, but it's just a movement. And so something's either given or it's not, and there's not really that old mechanism anymore. So it's all just a backdrop for mind training, including that. You know, it's no different really than dancing or eating, or, you know, it's really the spirit will use it. So if there's a willingness in the mind for it to be used in that way, it's, yeah, it's very good. It's no different to anything else. Yeah.
I think there was one over here.
Mozart said the most important part of music is the chord.
Mm. There you go. Mozart was on.
Would you say that there are many ways to know God as there are individuals? In by saying that, I mean that we're talking about a special relationship here, and how that works with the mind of the two people focused on receiving the messages from God. But there are many people who work at receiving this, receiving God into their hearts, by having different kinds of relationships. So there's no particularly right way or wrong way about growing, is there? Does that make sense?
Yeah, in the context of A Course in Miracles, he says it's a highly individualized curriculum. And so it's really always just pray, listen, follow. That's our practice. And you can never look to somebody else. There's no cookie cutter approach to awakening. You can never look and say, oh, they're doing that, so that's what it... It's like, it's all for your relationship with the Spirit, so that you come into relationship as the Spirit. And so, yeah, it's just pray, listen, and follow. So it will look different for different ones. Well, for me, I don't feel like I've chosen to go into relationship or not go into relationship. I've heard the guidance for something and I've followed that. So that's as simple as it is for me. So I could never be in relationship that wasn't given by the Spirit. It just would be. I just couldn't do it, actually. No. Because it's relationship with the self, you know, listening to the Spirit. So yeah, whether it doesn't really matter, the form is kind of irrelevant, you know. The healing will come because everything is mind, so mind will bring whatever it is that's required for your healing.
Yeah, well, we're into an area now of guidance. It's a beautiful area. It's what we're being led into, you know, the last five lessons of A Course in Miracles is all about letting him be in charge, giving it completely over to the Spirit. That's where he leaves us off. You know, this has been a mind training exercise, and the mind training's got to keep going to switch our thought system and give it over to the Spirit. And so what we find is really important, in fact, is to join with our mighty companions on what can be big decisions. You know, feel like something, if you're talking about being in relationship or with partners, or you know, something that feels like it's reasonably significant and fairly what seems like insignificant things we often join around. And we do that because we are, you know, until we're completely awakened, there is an ego darkened lens that needs to be washed. And so there is the filter coming through. And although the guidance can seem clear in your mind, there can be the ego being there, being the sneaky one, coming in saying, oh, you know, this is the guidance. You can feel, you know, or you might be attracted to one and say, oh, I'm meant to, you know, be with them. And this is where we find the mighty companions incredibly helpful. Then they really haven't got an agenda, and they're really willing to heal, to be able to join with mighty companions and say, hey, look, this is what I'm feeling at the moment. What do you feel? To be able to all pause and pray together is when it's just so powerful, actually. That's when things become very, very clear about a direction of whatever needs to happen. Because there is only one guidance. It's a very, very important part of guidance, is there is only one guidance. It's the beautiful thing. When we follow guidance, it is actually a blessing for the whole. That there is not an individual guidance. There's not my guidance and your guidance, which, again, I think a lot of Course in Miracles students, you know, decide or misinterpret what Jesus is saying. There's one guidance, and to help go through that egoic darkened lens, that the thought system that is very, very sneaky, to join with others with a shared intention and pray about something, or just to pray together, is actually very powerful. But if there is a big decision, to join together, and then you'll hear it. And if you're not all hearing the same thing, then there's some sort of, the ego's getting involved somewhere. And that's when it's a great opportunity to share your thoughts about whatever they are. And that's when you're undoing the blocks to the awareness of love's presence, you're putting them on the table, and then praying further, the actual guidance will come through that is unified, that is the same, we'll just hear the same thing. And the more you do that, the more it starts becoming a habit, and there's nothing else you want to do. This is, again, we practice a lot together, and is just incredible. And so what happens is, it doesn't really matter what happens in form. All that happens is that you can linger in time, and linger in time and suffering. It's delay. It's hanging out in meaninglessness. How long do you want to do that for? In doing it enough, thank you very much. You know, I just want to do in each moment exactly what the Spirit wants me to do. Because why? Because in each moment, when I'm doing whatever the Spirit wants me to do, I'm actually doing the most effective thing for my awakening in that moment. And for the whole sanction. I mean, is there anything more unselfish you could possibly be doing? You know, it's the most helpful thing to be able to be following guidance. Yeah. So, the Spirit will then direct you exactly where you're meant to be, when you're meant to be, who you're meant to be with in each moment. And I've got to say, it's an incredibly glorious way to live. I can't possibly live any other way now because I've been doing it for quite some time. And the undoing that's happened has been amazing, and it's still happening. And I just love it. There's nothing else I want to do.
Yeah, g'day.
G'day.
you might have answered this already, I'm not sure. There was a question I had at lunch at the office of having the hour, and I mentioned this question. I'm not sure if you touched on it before, but basically, I just wondered if pursuit of desire, it seems to me, right, I've just got this question, it seems to me perhaps pursuit of desire could, of course, get in the way of, like, complete alignment, if you like, or I don't know what, but, I mean, I'm pretty new to this, I heard about this stuff yesterday. So, is there a pure pursuit? Is there a pure pursuit of desire, or is pursuit of desire just automatically straight away? Well, you're just off the line there, brother. What's going on?
Yeah. Well, the spirit is a state of desirelessness. However, a bit like I said earlier, the Holy Spirit will meet the mind exactly where it thinks it's at. And so you're going to see desires in the mind for whatever it is. And it's really just being able to give them to the Holy Spirit. And as Michael's saying, just take the hands off them. And the way we do that is, you know, it seems to be, we just join around everything and pray into it. But yeah, desire, just being able to hand them over and know that you're not in charge of what the form looks like. You'll still see those things in the mind. I'm not sure exactly what your question is.
So if you ask,
do you have an example? Yeah, that's helpful.
I love riding motorcycles.
Yes.
And I like riding in the desert, so.
Yeah, so, you know, I like to do a lot of things, and that's one of them. I love riding a motorcycle in the desert. I just went across the Simpson a few months ago in the winter, and a few journeys like that. But often I think of these things, and I think, I would love to do that. And then I think, and then there's... Then there's, I imagine, some emptiness of, oh, yes, yeah, what is it you want to try and go away from here for and go there? Mm-hmm. And when you're there, you want to go somewhere else. I mean, I've got a story around that. Later on, we ended up calling, let's go somewhere else, because we could never go anywhere. We would arrive at places, but we wouldn't arrive because we'd start to, you know, just get a feel for the place, and you'd go, let's go somewhere else. go there, you know. and so I kind of often don't do those things because I can pretty quickly eliminate them from some, put them down to some desire, some frivolous pursuit or something. I should mow the grass or something. I mean, and so maybe I look for a higher, perhaps if I can, I don't know, yeah, take, I don't know, and find a reason then to, but the, you know, this is the funny thing, because the ego can quickly find reasons to fulfill the deed and off you go. But, I do wonder then if it's just a major distraction all the time, anytime, what's this new pursuit you want to do? What's wrong with right here, right now, in your own space, in your own body with this deal? You want to go somewhere else? I don't know.
Well, I would say if you have a passion for riding a motorbike through the desert, then just give it to the spirit. It's a bit like I had a passion for moving. There was nothing, you know, special about moving, but the spirit used it as a mind training backdrop for me. So, and it was very helpful. And then when that's done, and now it seems to come back in, you know, little ways, but it's being used. So the spirit will, the Holy Spirit will use everything that we seem to believe in form to wind the mind back to the remembrance of the truth. But that's very abstract to just try and jump to, well, why can't I just be, you know, it's like really let the Holy Spirit meet you where you think you're at. Even write it all down and then be willing to just, okay, hand it over and now you bring me what is most helpful because I don't really perceive my own best interests. So, but there's nothing like there's nothing wrong with seeing the desires in the mind. It's the judgment of them that gets in the way. Just being willing to hand them over. Maybe you'll go right in the desert with your mobile. I don't know.
Just in relation to that, I don't know if I'm right or wrong, but there's no right or wrong, is there? I sort of feel this is important to say, and that's there's only one judgment that we're really allowed, or Jesus says there's only one real judgment, and that is to judge if it feels right, if it feels good or not. So if it feels good, do it. But if there's some sort of angst about whether you should do it, then maybe it's the ego asking you to do it. So spirit, when you follow spirit, it feels right, feels good. And when you follow ego, it doesn't.
Yeah, just practice.
That's what I feel. Can you
get in the direction of it, and how do you feel? You'll have the contrast experience. Okay, maybe we'll just take one last question. I kind of feel like we're wrapping up.
Maybe you can tell me if I'm on the right track. It's something in that situation that I've asked myself to give myself clarity is if I'm attracted to something, whether it's a food or an activity or a person, I don't ask myself whether it feels good or bad, but I ask myself how emotionally attached to it am I? So if I didn't get what I wanted, would I be distressed or have a negative feeling, or could I just go, okay, I can let that go easily? Mm. So it's how emotionally attached, am I emotionally attached to it? That's my question, to see whether it's a healthy desire or not. Is that the right thing I should be doing?
Yeah, that question that Jesus says to ask us, which is a beautiful question, how do I feel? It's an incredibly important one. It's a great one to use. You know, we've had a couple of really good, simple questions that Jesus has asked, we've talked about today, which is great. How do I feel is very, very powerful and, again, can be easily misconstrued by the ego. How do I feel? Do I feel good? Okay. I just go, well, the ego can feel good about all sorts of things. You know, the ego wants adrenaline rushes. You know, it's an adrenaline junkie. You know, it can feel good about all sorts of things. What is this feeling good? It's actually, what I've found, it's more about a heaviness or a lightness, which is actually very different to good or bad in a way. You know, if something feels heavy, then that's going to be the ego, you know, because everything with the spirit, in fact, is light. You know, and oftentimes the spirit is going to stretch you, or things are going to be uncomfortable. A bit, whether it's getting into a relationship you may not necessarily want to get into. Not that I didn't want to hear. or, you know, it could be anything. I mean, I've had all these different things I've had to do that I'm just not interested in doing ordinarily in the world, and yet I could feel there was a lightness around doing it, and yet I just didn't want to do it. I thought, oh, this is the last thing I ever want to do. But I could feel there was a lightness to it, you know? And so it's very different to good or bad, really. It's a lightness or a heaviness. That's the best way I can say it. It's not a not easy to put into words, but if something feels like, oh, this would be great to do, but there's a heaviness, or there's a but at all, actually, you know, and there's a bit of a heaviness, if you like, that's where you go, hang on, is this really what it's about? And if there's any question, then this is, again, where I come back to Mighty Companion. It's great to feel it out, because then it becomes really obvious when you join, okay, is this the way to go or not, you know?
How about feeling at peace?
Feeling at peace is Yes, that's lightness. I'd call that lightness. And it's a consistent lightness. I think that's another good way to look at it. If something feels like you're not sure and you feel, I think I feel good about this, I think I feel light about it, and you go ahead and do it and it starts feeling heavy, that's a really good indication. That's the ego, you know. Because it continues to feel light. In fact, you feel more and more uplifted the more you get involved with the spirit, the more you head in the direction of the spirit. So if there's not a continual upliftment, that's a good indication that you're siding with the ego. And again, we come back to as an experiment. You know, you can't go wrong. You know, if you've been doing something seemingly heavy for a long time and you've invested a lot of time and money into it, you know, don't keep doing it. If you realize it's just not happening, you know, go for the lightness. Go and do something else. Go do anything else if you don't even know what to do. Just try something else to see how that feels in the moment. You know, that's what we often say. And it's even like, you know, that guidance or that lightness can happen with anything. Even reading the course. If you read the course when it's not guided in the moment, you know, you've read the course when you start, you've got to keep reading the same line over and over again. Anyone ever experienced that? Or read the same paragraph over and over again? Guess what? It's time to put it down. You think, oh, I've got to read this extra paragraph or I'm supposed to. No, that's not it. That's the heaviness. And that's when it becomes indicative. Okay, now it's time to go do something else. It might be a walk, it might be whatever it is. Go do the dishes or, you know. And that's it. It's like, you know, we oftentimes say, it's like there's no better thing to be doing in form than another if it's given by the Spirit. That's the most helpful thing to do in the moment. Like sitting up here, it might look like this is the most helpful thing to be doing. And yet if I'm meant to be scrubbing a toilet in this moment, this is going to feel like crap. And, you know, and if I'm meant to be speaking in front of a bunch of people and scrubbing a toilet, that's going to feel like crap if I'm meant to be here. You know, like it becomes really evident when you follow the Spirit. It's just like whatever is given, it doesn't matter what you're doing in form, really, really. If it's given by the Spirit, it's going to be joyful. And that's where the lightness is going to be. That's where the joy is going to be.
I think purpose answers that too. Like Jesus has another great question, what is it for? Hmm. With everything, what is it for? Is this moving me in the direction of undoing my mind, or is this moving me in the direction of going back to sleep in linear time? And I love what you said. David would say this for years, and it actually took me a long time to start believing it, that you can't mess it up. You know, like the shot to, you know, the rite of awakening isn't like a straight shot. I mean, it would be if we had no resistance, but that's pretty rare. It looks more like this, you know. And the Holy Spirit will just keep redirecting. So you can't really get it wrong, and that's very reassuring. But what is it for is a good question. Is this to help me sleep more in linear time, or is this really for the undoing of my mind? I think I feel like we're done. Thank you very much for listening to us today. It's like an honour to be here with all of you guys, and we're very blessed to have so many people who are devoted to A Course in Miracles in one place. And we get to play with each other for 3 days. Yeah, Michael and I are inspired by the Spirit to have a little tour. Starting next year, we're available. So I actually have some business cards, that's a funny word. I have some cards that I just had printed the other day. If anyone wants to contact us, we live like David lives, just open to the invitation. So I would happily answer anyone's call for healing, because it's my call. So if anyone's interested in having us come to do anything, we're available, because we're pretty sparked to just keep shining and sharing what we're learning, because it's all for us. So thank you so much. And David and Francis have just come back from a European/China/Japan tour, and they'll be speaking on Sunday, so if you're not already going, I highly encourage you to go and see them. It's like a living demonstration. So, yeah, and then we're having a retreat in Machi, which is where Michael and I live next week, starting next Thursday. And there are still places, and there's information about that at the back too. Thank you all very much.
Yeah, there's also plenty of books and you know, some wonderful resources back there where David's sitting. And Colin's looking after those, so see him about some amazing resources. David's never written a book. It's been volunteers that have been drawn to his teachings that have put these books together from the teachings, and they're just really amazing. So avail yourself of those. There's some cards, these orange cards that say quantum forgiveness. They're fantastic. They give a lot of free resources online that you can grab one of those cards and you can see all the free resources. So, yeah. And there's also a newsletter that we have that really keep you up to date every month. It's great teachings, just what's happening in the book. people's community, where David is, what have you. There's a sign-up sheet there if you want to be able to get that, keep in touch with us. So. Okay.